take the high road. Lay down our weary load and rejoice that we're going home to the nearest faraway place where we will live in grace forevermore there. We're not concerned how, for the way we'll know to the place that He has prepared so well. So won't you stand up and lift your heads high and sing together, we're going home, yeah, we're going home, yeah, we're going home, yeah, we're going home, yeah, we're going home.
I know a lot of you might be wondering, when are these videos ever going to get to the real good stuff? The real good stuff. Well, fair enough. We have been getting to a lot of really good stuff. For instance, to release everyone from any necessity, say, to be bound to any circumstances whatsoever. I give everybody absolute freedom from all circumstances, forever and forever. This attitude is the good stuff, really. Because that opens up a door. You see, what door does it open up? Well, that's what people want to know. But if you don't know how to open this door, what good is the information going to do you about what's behind the door, so to speak? You have to know how to open the door. So that's why we've been focusing on this for so much, and we'll continue to do so. But there is, of course, the other side of the situation, which is what's going to happen coming up in this world. Now, I was shown in 1998, was it? January, I think. I was shown like a movie of the future during sleep. It was very clear that I was being shown what's going to happen in this world. It's been very accurate. This movie's been very accurate in hindsight. And what I would have been shown is ultimately quite amazing scenario for this planet. Now, I've been looking at this world, and in my videos I'm saying that there's just this corporate, global corporate goddess culture has been institutionalized on the planet. Materialism, spiritual materialism, it's now the prominent world institution. Absolutely is the most prominent world institution above everything else. It is incredibly powerful, incredibly entrenched, and it's generating super bad habits for everybody. Just to be on this planet is to be incredibly contaminated. This planet is like a garbage dump for the cosmos. Those who have the most severe continuity problems end up here on planet Earth, it seems like. I was at a gas station today, and just, you know, the attendant comes out shuffling. I say, whoa, there's somebody who's really heavy traumatized something. He's got the most scary death shirt on I've ever seen. He's got a bracelet full of heavy metal skull heads, you know. He's shaking the bracelet, and he's just like, he's so, and I say, wow, you know, he's just here's someone who's, you know, severely oppressed by the continuity fear, severely oppressed. And then I'm looking around, there's other people who are slouching around with just tattoos just head to toe, and just say, wow, just all over the place. And this is one of the nicest places in the world, actually. You can tell that this is a garbage dump for the cosmos when those who have the most severe continuity problems end up in this garbage dump. And of course, then they project that that they can be happy here, so they want a goddess figure to tell them, don't worry, I can make the flesh and materialism wonderful for you. You never have to face your continuity fear of your true self, which dwells within, which is everywhere, actually. You never have to deal with that. I'll keep you happy here with materialism. So this has been institutionalized. You have all this garbage dump acquiring all the hard nut cases of the cosmos coming here. And it's a very bad scenario in terms of generating bad habits, fragmenting attention, putting your attention where it's not helpful. The religion of this planet is failure is success. That's the mantra. That's the mantra of the goddess. Failure is success. Failure is success. Failure is success. That's the mantra. Fail to be helped, and you'll never have to face what you turned your back on, you know, tried to turn your back on, reality. You'll never have to face it. This is the dream of the fearful ones, always. And of course, this is futile, because you've never separated. You cannot separate from reality. In fact, all this dream is taking place in reality. So there's just a waste of time. It's just a waste of time. So in studying this world and monitoring it my whole life, I see it generates terrible bad habits. Right now, it's been globally institutionalized to just be a factory of bad habits, which simply cause you delay. That's all it does. Never has a stable outcome. Never a stable outcome. It's only delay. You have, no one has any choice, but they must turn around and face and accept what they truly are. Okay, what truly is reality. And the more bad habits you have, the tougher the path is, the more you think, you make excuses. Well, I can't do it. There's no excuses. You have to. Everyone has to do it. So my remedy, this is my remedy. I don't know if this is not coming. I don't know if it's coming from the Holy Spirit or not, but I'm just saying what I see is what I would do. I would take everyone off this planet right now. Okay. Everyone off this planet. And I would relocate them to other planets. Then I would melt this planet down. Okay. Clean it. All the pollution, all the contamination, all the technology, all the institutions of that generate these bad habits. Absolutely everything would be melted down, and the planet would go through a refurbishing mode, and it would then would be turned into a fourth dimensional planet, would be terraformed, and you know, that would be how I would see it. And that's what I was showing them in the video, actually, in this movie. While I was during sleep, my body was asleep, but my consciousness was very awake. That's what I saw happening. The planet was going to be melted down. And so I agree, this is the best route to go. Take everyone off this planet right now. Take them to places where there is no technology. What I see, but there may be various places to take people, but this world is not doing anyone any good, in my opinion. What I see is going to what's called a pilgrim planet. A pilgrim planet. Let's say we were taken off this planet and we find ourselves in a pilgrim planet. Well, this pilgrim planet has what we see, the forms that we're used to as nature there. Okay, but it is beautiful. It is clean. And what you do on a pilgrim planet is you simply trek through beautiful paths, along beautiful paths, just the scenery, everything is so beautiful. And your goal is to a pilgrimage site, a holy sacred pilgrimage site, where in residence are enlightened beings. Okay. And you spend your time trekking to these places. You don't have any, there's no need for any money whatsoever, because there's fruit and nuts and whatever, nuts, stuff growing on trees in such profuse abundance. Anywhere you are, you can eat fruit, just pick it off of a tree. And the reason why you spend time walking and trekking to a goal is because here in this world, everybody is so into go, 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 go. They can't sit still. They can't sit still. They have to be moving. They have to be going somewhere. So you cannot just take people to planet and say, just sit here quietly in meditation. It doesn't work. You have to convert the energy and the momentum of going and getting, I got to get somewhere, I got to do something, you know, into a pilgrimage. So I call it the pilgrimage planet. And there are many holy sites throughout this planet. Many. And the number of treks you can take are almost unlimited, and they are absolutely beautiful. And so you may walk for like 10 days or a couple weeks or so, some less for some treks, and you make it into a pilgrimage, and then you arrive at this even more stunningly beautiful place, and you spend time there just being the beauty. Quiet, some quiet time. You start getting used to quiet time, to being still, to sitting quietly. And then when the restlessness grips you again, you're off to the next pilgrimage site. And this is similar to what was in place on this planet at some point, okay? Or like the system that Adi Shankara set up in India was that you would go on pilgrimages, ceaselessly going on pilgrimages throughout, you know, all these different places throughout India and the Himalayas and like that, with sacred sites, you would visit them. Very similar, okay? So, but it's on a different planet, okay? Not on this planet anymore. And that you would be dedicated to that. You wouldn't have possessions like a home like that. And you wouldn't need it. You wouldn't need it because the atmosphere there is perfect. You'll be taken care of. Your body there will be transformed in certain ways so that walking pilgrimages is effortless for you. It's easy. The point is your mind, your attention is what needs to be healed. And so, like I said, the act of, I know so many people love to recreate, they love to go on hikes and stuff like that. It'd be like going on hikes every day, except you say, well, I'm hiking the Pacific Coast Trail or the, you know, the Sierra, the Ridge Trail or whatever. But no, it wouldn't be rugged like that, not so rugged. It's more pastoral pilgrimages, okay. There might be some variations along the way, sure. And you'd be making these beautiful pastoral pilgrimages. And you would be no technology at all, okay? No gadgets, no stuff, ornamentation, trinkets, no, you know, pilgrim, you're a pilgrim. But you would be singing songs along the way. You'd be singing, you would be call and response spiritual songs, spiritual practice actually, on your path to this, through these various holy sites. And you would spend, you know, your time in that way. So this is a general picture of what I would do. I would disperse various groups into various pilgrimage planets. Okay. Now, how could we have pilgrimage planets? Easy. Someone like Jesus can manifest a pilgrimage planet instantly, like that. Can manifest a billion of them instantly, actually. So there's absolutely no problem whatsoever to manifest a gorgeous pilgrimage planet. No technology, no buildings are there at all. Okay, there are no buildings. I don't know about the holy sites, if there's some monument there, or how what they would look like actually. Maybe not. Fresh water everywhere. So drinking fresh water and fruit, abundant fruit everywhere. Never any possibility of anybody going hungry. Okay, along pilgrimage site. As far as your health would probably be, you know, excellent. Your body would be in perfect shape to do these pilgrimages. Because what's important is not your body, it's your mind and your attention. And it's our attention. Remember, our attention is spiritual, and that survives the death of the body, and it continues on. So when we have an attention problem, yeah, that's a severe issue, which is derived from our continuity fear. We keep trying to fragment our attention. So somebody would say, "Wow, I just got to go somewhere. Okay, I need to keep going. You can't stop them, right? This is the planet. This is the bad habits everybody has. They can't focus in. They cannot. Very few are able to do this anymore. And the atmosphere of this planet, spiritually, is being contaminated so terribly by this institutionalization of this New World Order, goddess material, spiritual material cult, actually. And you know, so staying here, you can get worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. And I can't do anything about it here. I've tried my whole life, get nowhere, absolutely nowhere. So I would rapture everyone off the planet, absolutely. Everyone who wanted to go, but I wouldn't put any conditions on who can go. I'd say my invitation is for everybody to go. Without any exception whatsoever, none. Everybody can be put in a better situation than here on this planet, everybody. But maybe not everybody's gonna go. So they may stay here and they may, you know, deal with the situation that is here, and it's not going to be a pretty sight. And as I said, I believe this planet is going to be melted down. And turned into a very different planet. Actually, I saw it's all level. The whole planet is level, like a cue ball, basically. The soil is all different. It's all powdery, soft powdery, kind of. The whole planet is changed. And then I saw arriving from spaceships, and also somehow coming out from under the ground, all these different beings in this planet. And they begin terraforming the planet, planting everywhere. And they turned it into this kind of a lush type of fourth dimensional planet. So I'd say third dimensional planet here is essentially finished. It's essentially finished. Now, I don't have any days, etc. And I think that's for a reason. What the Holy Spirit told us, nobody knows the date and the day. That keeps us from fixating on it. You know, if you knew a date ahead of time, say, well, okay, I can wait. I see a lot of people fixating on dates and how, trying to figure out what's the date. They're not spending their time on preparing, which is to give absolute freedom to all. Okay, absolute freedom to all. Give complete freedom from all circumstances to everybody. And I'm practicing this today. I saw that guy at the gas station. Wow, was he locked into a heavy trip. And I gave him complete freedom from all circumstances. So I didn't see him as a body, as a person. I saw him as spirit. And I saw everyone at the gas station as spirit. None of them, from my standpoint, are bound by any circumstance whatsoever. It's simply they have a continuity fear that causes them to keep pulling this attitude, you know. But they're not bound by it. I say, I don't need to see you as bound by anything. I don't need to see you as bound by anything. That attitude, I don't need to see anyone bound by any circumstance whatsoever. I don't need to see the universe bound by any circumstance. This is the ascensional attitude, okay? This is an attitude of ascension. This is how you can ascend. This is how you can go to a different planet, is you give absolute freedom to everybody. So where's the guilt? If you feel someone else can't leave, how can you feel that you can leave? You see, if you're binding somebody else, you're actually bound by that, because it's your, in your mind. You see, bondage is in your mind. When you bind someone else, the bondage is in your mind. You're extending the bondage in your mind to them. So remove that. As Jesus said, cast out the mote in your own eye, you see. It starts with us, and it starts with each one of us. Grant absolute freedom to everyone. Total, unconditional. No one is bound by any circumstances whatsoever. Never have been. They never have been. And never will be. This is an ascensional attitude. So with that in mind, you can easily say, oh, well, we can go somewhere else. Absolutely. The last thing I would want to see is people continue to function on this planet under the what's taking place here. The invasion of garbage here in this planet, and the technology and all this stuff is in terms of your attention, it is a nightmare. It is a nightmare. So I certainly give freedom to everybody to go somewhere else. That's my viewpoint. Is I absolutely see everyone as absolutely free of any conditions whatsoever. They're perfectly free to go somewhere else. Everyone on this planet. Because all I see is everyone is caught in the same exact same problem, continuity fear. I see everything is universal. There's simply this continuity fear, and there's nothing else, no other problem. They're not good, they're not bad, they're not this. You see these people, and I could just tell, you know, this is someone's worshiping death. There's so many death cults on this planet right now, people worshiping death cults. I'd be very surprised, you know. And often a beautiful woman, a goddess, is used as a head figure of these death cults. And they feel they're being saved, you know, saved from something horrible. They're hiding in what they call death, hiding. There's a backstory, of course, for what we truly are. That's the sin that we're engaged in, is we're imagining there's a backstory to reality. Before reality was reality, this is what it was. It's a backstory. We're imagining a story. that took place. That, in other words, we believe we're causing reality. We're the cause of reality. Our imagination is the cause of reality. It is not. And because we've been doing this and so invested in it, we're now terrified to turn and see what we really are. Because what we are is completely perfect. And we'll say, wow, there's no way there could ever be a backstory to this. There isn't any backstory at all. It's like, uh-oh, big continuity issue. Because I'm so invested in the backstory. So we tend to be terrified of this and hide from it in deep, dark backstories. You know, imagine death, terrible death and destruction and disappearance. And, I'm just this, rotting hunk of flesh. And how could I possibly be this perfect, perfect being? We keep trying to identify with that. And so you see those who are, I saw these spirits identifying with all these death shirts, death tattoos. It's not enough for them to have death tattoos all over. The clothing is all now tattooed with death skulls and everything. The jewelry's got death skulls. They're just like, and their attitude was just zonked out, just like heavy. But again, I saw them as perfectly free of that, intrinsically free, inherently, intrinsically, utterly untouched by that, totally free. So this is the attitude we have to everyone who stays in the world. That is perfectly okay. They are not bound by any circumstances whatsoever. Nothing is forcing them to stay. See, this is the thing. Ascension is for everyone. Ascension is for everyone. Those who choose to stay, they want to keep their hiding place. They want to keep hiding out because of the continuity fear. Nobody's forcing them to stay. I would welcome everyone to go to a pilgrimage planet. Absolutely. And you can shuffle along there, and it will save you untold misery, actually. So maybe the entire planet will just all find ourselves instantly in different realms, on pilgrimage planets, just instantly. That's possible. It's absolutely possible. I don't know how it's going to work. We may all leave it all at once, the whole planet. But there may be some that don't want to leave, so... And of course, that would be a big old no. When those who leave, it's a big no to what's going on this planet. Say, no way. No way, Jose. You're not going to stay here. And they might, something to chew on, something to think about, say, can't quite figure that one out. So, I would say this should happen soon. Happen soon. Do we know when? No. Don't obsess with times and dates. Certainly put yourself under pressure, saying, if you get a feeling like I need to be ready by like October 1st, which I was, which I actually, the night of the 30th, I released the whole universe from any need for any conditions whatsoever. I saw the universe as totally free, unbound by any condition whatsoever, always and forever. I share with everyone is perfect freedom. I share perfect freedom from all circumstance. No one is bound by any circumstance whatsoever. And I'm perfectly okay with that. September 30th, just before October 1st started. And that was very timely because now we are into this, new phase. We're into October phase. And I said the fall of this 2014 is one when we are going to get the new phase of intensity, and it is certainly here with us now. And yet at the same time, understanding ascension is here too, you see. Now, by the way, there'll be no progeny on these pilgrimage planets, no families. We may have our bodies transformed into just to unigender bodies, and wear simple clothing, just maybe a robe or, a frock or something. Nobody cares about what other people look like. Okay, you're not focused on bodies. You're focusing on the pilgrimage and the beauty as you go through the pilgrimage to pilgrimage sites, and that's your focus there. And your body will live as long as you need it to, that sort of thing. I think it'll be different. And of course, this planet used to have that. There used to be a system here, a pilgrimage system, a Very much so. Even in Europe, there's a tremendous amount of pilgrimages taking place in the Middle Ages, before the quote-unquote Age of Enlightenment, which really means science, the age of what we have now, this ghastly mega corporate planet Earth Incorporated, focusing everyone on consumerism, materialism, fragmenting your attention. Before that, a rope began to arise on this planet. And like I said, in a lot of countries, other countries, in the East, the pilgrimages, very much so. You'd go from a monastery to another monastery. You'd travel a lot of traveling on pilgrimages, where you do your prayers as you travel. You sing your songs, you say your prayers, you enjoy the pilgrimage, and then you get there, you enjoy a little quiet time. And then gradually, you may want to stay in one of these holy sites as someone who's in more intense practice of sitting quietly, trying every day some quiet time, stuff like that. And along the way of the pilgrimage, you can also spend time, like you reach a certain time of the day, you start out before in the morning. I don't know if there's morning, evening, and night, if those cycles, maybe it's just light all the time, it's possible. No need for sleep. You spend some quiet time. And you'd be amazed over the years of doing this, over a lifetime of doing this, you'll be transformed. This past, the way the world is now, be like a dream to you. It's like a dream, like a ridiculous dream from that perspective. And it can happen much sooner than you believe. Even the worst people on this planet can be transformed. Those who have the most severe continuity fear will absolutely have their attention transformed into capable to liberate the entire universe. From their mind, they will say, I set the entire universe and the universe of universes and all the totality. For me, I set it all free. It is never bound by any circumstance or situation whatsoever. It is absolutely free. And you'll be able to do that. You'll be able to do it. Now, if this planet continues the way it is, I don't have any answer whatsoever, because everything I've tried to do assuming that it will continue, has been trying to generate, what can we do? Nothing has worked. And the Holy Spirit doesn't seem to be supporting any of that whatsoever. Matter of fact, when you try to help the future of this planet, what you end up is you end up listening to the goddess and getting advice for her, because that's what she's invested in, is the future of this planet as a eternal hiding place from truth, really. Being just a psychic projection of our continuity fear, being an expression of our collective expression of our continuity fear, the goddess seems to be very powerful and attractive in saying, you tell us, don't worry, you'll never have to turn around and face reality the way it really is. We can always stay in this dualistic, in this dream. So you end up getting advice from her about how to help the future of this planet. But as far as the Holy Spirit goes, I've never gotten any advice as to what to do here in this planet, or from Jesus either. I don't have a clue. I really don't have a clue as how can this world be helped. Nothing. No matter how much I pray, nothing arises. And my own future here is zero. As far as work, as far as money, as far as functioning here, no, not like destitution. So I say, Holy Spirit, why aren't you helping me out? And no reply, you know. It's like, wow. So just adding all that up, I think, you know, maybe there will be an exodus. Maybe there will be a rapture. Maybe there will be a relocation, which would be the best thing possible. Not everybody agree, because a lot of people say, wow, this world's like perfect, like heaven for us. We can be able to distract ourselves endlessly here. But the problem is you get tired of distractions, and you need more and more severe distractions, more and more severe projections of thinking that somebody is persecuting you. You end up with paranoid, persecution complexes, depression, war, you name it. Control freaks. What we have here is another thing, is psychic domination by women over men. Very severe. I got a call from some company. They're sending me stuff all the time. I don't want the stuff. I don't want it. I send them one order, and they're sending me catalogs, and it was some very sweet-sounding maiden on the phone, you know, and And she says, oh, I just want to ask you a few questions. Do we have your address right? And anyone else we'd like to send it to? Can you give me your email address? And I wanted to say, no, stop sending me stuff. I'm not interested in that stuff. If I want something, I will look online, choose what I want, and I'll order it. I don't need all this constant barrage of materials. But she was so sweet and got nice, you know. And I felt I couldn't say no. I couldn't say no. I was like, I said, and after the conversation ended, I said, that's ridiculous. How come I couldn't say no? And then, of course, I realized men have been conditioned to not fluster women at all. If I said no, she would have been flustered. Like, well, why don't you want? I don't understand. The whole act of, oh, I'm so flustered by your response. And I realized all men have been conditioned on this planet. Don't say anything that will fluster women. Just fluster them out. And, of course, you're under total psychic domination by women. Total psychic domination. Because whatever they want, they can say, oh, this is real sweet, this is what I want, and if you disagree with me, I'm going to be so flustered. And so we've gotten already to the level of we can't say anything as a man that will fluster a woman. And so she can just pretend to be flustered any way she wants, get whatever, have steer things whatever way she wants to. Now, other women can certainly speak up against other women, most definitely. A lot of them have no problem with that whatsoever. I'm amazed when I hear another woman just put another woman, just boom, you know. I'm like, God, I can't do that at all. Are you kidding me? Well, that's good for them, but it's terrible for men. Absolutely terrible. Who wants to be enslaved, psychically enslaved? I sure don't. Not in the slightest bit. I don't want women standing up for me and trying to take care of them. I want to take care of my own business here. If I want to say no, I want to say no. And I realize that men really cannot say no anymore to women. It's not possible. It's really not possible. And so I said, hey, that's terrible. Who wants to live under psychic enslavement? Not me. No way. So opportunity to get to go to another place, Pilgrim Planet, absolutely I'm there. Now, I would be happy to be a pilgrim. I'd be happy to be a part of the holy sites. I'd be happy to be maybe a guide of the pilgrims. Maybe they're guides that help the pilgrims along, you know, and suggest songs to them, spiritual practices as they take a pilgrimage. Maybe I'll be like that. Absolutely, any role is fine. Any role is fine. But see, we don't realize that psychic domination is what's called the matriarchy. That's what used to dominate this planet. The matriarchy used to dominate this planet, completely dominated males on this planet for thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands. And it was done psychically. Okay, it's just women are very psychic. Many of the women in this world now are using their psychic abilities to an extreme extent, and they're using it to control men. Absolutely, and gain dominance and have a whole slave class, and of course doing it nicely and sweetly, like, so that's what you want too, you know, because I'm so nice and you want to be with me, and that makes you happy, and so you don't want to fluster me because I won't be happy, and they won't be able to be with me, and you won't be happy. So it's this kind of nonsense, you know. Nonsense. No, we don't want secular materialism. No, we don't want this consumer culture. No, we don't want these bad habits. No, we don't want to even stay here. See, oh, but that flusters, I'm so bad, you can't say that kind of stuff, you know. So, if people are looking for domination, thinking that you know, it's the bad guy shooting. No, it's the velvet glove of psychic domination that's the corporations have put through their programming and entertainment and commercials and advertising. The whole thing is put this entire thing into, and then now the laws are more and more also there saying you can't disappoint the woman. You can't get her angry. If you do, that shows that you're a very wicked, evil person. This is marketing. This is how we've been conditioned on this by its propaganda. We're worried about the propaganda of the Chinese or whatever. Well, yeah, sure. But the propaganda of Hollywood and Madison Avenue is way worse than the propaganda of China. Okay. The communist propaganda is way worse because it gets you thinking that you're fortunate to be propagandized by all this stuff. You're fortunate. Look at this gold mine of materialism you're going to get by doing this, you know, and all that. Of course, you're losing your spiritual focus as you're doing this. And you're losing the realization of your freedom and everyone else's freedom, actually, as you're doing this. You can't be free alone. It's impossible. You cannot be saved alone. It's impossible. You're only saved when everyone is saved. And everyone is saved when you set everyone free in your own spirit. They can choose to keep pretending they're not, but you know they are free. You see them as free. See, this is the goal Jesus has for us. Okay. Now, you'll never get this goal from the goddess. The goddess will never steer you towards true enlightenment. She'll always steer you away. You'll never get a yes from her, a permission from her goddess to be enlightened. Never. Because it's merely an expression of your continuity fear. And the continuity fear is always going to say, no, 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 it's dangerous. Don't do that. Here's an alternative. You know, don't worry. We'll make this world we'll make it, you know, bigger screen, higher definition. Don't worry. You know, higher def. Everyone goes, oh yeah, I can't leave this planet. They got higher def. It's like 5 dots now where there was one. You know, we don't need the fifth dimension. We've got 5 dots. 5 dots now of pixels where there was one before. Times 5 here. You know, now we can watch our, now we can have our attention fragmented by all this violence, sex and violence and confusion and attack and drama. We can have it fragmented and pulled in all different directions. So, you know, in higher definition. So everyone says, wow, I can't leave here. You know, I can't leave here. Got to wait for that higher definition. This is the madness of this place. Absolute madness. So people are, you know, willing slaves. Remember, the goddess is a projection of our continuity fear. Nevertheless, pragmatically, we have to talk about it, okay? Because it seems as though that there's some force that is deceiving and tricking you. And it is, but it is coming from your own fear, actually. It's not some external force doing this. Goddess is not something external to us. It is projection of our own fear in the most attractive form we can find to mislead us, you know, away from salvation, away from truth, away from giving everyone all freedom from all conditions whatsoever, away from that. And so, of course, we try to make it attractive and seductive and clever and you know, soft touch and all this stuff. So it can convince us, and all the better to convince us like that. But it will not, our continuity fear will not speak to us of what is truly salvation. Only that which is free of the continuity fear will speak to us of what is salvation. The Holy Spirit is within all of us, totally free of all continuity fear. Jesus Christ, totally free of all continuity fear, you see. None, no continuity fear whatsoever. You get the truth from those sources who have no continuity fear whatsoever. And what they tell you is quite different than what the projected goddess culture and advice will tell you. Very, very different, actually. So again, this is the good stuff. We're always trying to give the good stuff in these videos here. Very powerful. A lot to chew on. And, you know, again, date and time, no, don't have date and time. All I know is, whenever I ask, I say, it's urgent, 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 urgent. We are in very urgent times right now. Very urgent times. And again, I would rapture everyone. Without exception. Without exception to religion, race, religion, age, health, wealth. I would give an invitation. In fact, I do right now. I invite everybody to leave this planet. I invite everybody to leave this planet and go to a pilgrimage planet. And you will find your life there immeasurably better than here. No bills. No money to worry about. What do you need money for? All you need, you're just on a pilgrimage and you're eating food as you go along and you're drinking and you feel healthy and refreshed. What do you need money for? You don't. You see, there's no bills. There's no tax collectors. And you begin to think about the advantages of it, right? No collection agencies, no police, no prisons, no drugs, no vice, you know, no movies, no TVs, nothing just pulling, just distracting you in a negative sense. Whereas you go along on a pilgrimage, you can get this overall ambience as you go along of stillness, of quiet, of peace, of harmony, you know, and it gradually it seeps into you. As you do these pilgrimages, it seeps into you, seeps into you, seeps into you. Imperceptibly it seeps into you. Just like you go to a place with great fresh air and somehow you feel more oxygenated and it's still and quiet and you feel like you're being refreshed somehow, but it happens imperceptibly, really. You know, even driving on this planet is no fun anymore. Everybody's in such a hurry. I'm doing 65 and I say, well, that's fast enough. Everybody's just passing me by, you know, and it's rush. We used to just go like 45, all the windows open, and just looking outside and just taking in this big picture. The mountains are there, the valleys here are just enjoying it, just enjoying it. Not saying much at all. Maybe we'll stop, take a picture. Let's just stop here for a while. Let's have a snack. We'd stop, pull over the side of the road, have a snack, and just look out. Well, pilgrims, you know, pilgrimage, you can do that every day, so to speak. And again, our bodies would have to be suitably transformed to be able to handle that, of course. And it's easy. Once you say that no one is bound to any conditions whatsoever, you're giving yourself freedom also, that you're not bound either. When I say no one, I'm including myself, okay? No one is bound by any conditions. I'm not bound either. So I can transform my body any way I want to. It can be transformed like that. Age gone, you see, infirmity gone. Everyone's that way. I give everyone absolute permission to transform their body instantly right now. You may weigh 400 pounds, next instant you can weigh 160. You may be old, next moment you can be in perfect age, 25, great health. You may have arthritis, next moment your body feels as flexible and fluid, as perfectly flexible and fluid. So from my standpoint, nobody is bound by any circumstances whatsoever, this very instant. And that goes on forever, right? And retroactively too, no one's ever been bound. So. As far as sickness, I'm sick. You're not sick. I don't see you as sick as at all. I see you as totally unbound by any circumstances whatsoever. That sickness is merely an expression of your continuity fear. That's all that I see it. It's just an expression, an appearance of continuity fear. You are not bound by any expression of what you are whatsoever. Okay. And remember, no. We are not bound by what we're hallucinating, by what we're expressing. The one that's expressing is not bound by what they're expressing. Absolutely not. That's the law of creation. That's the law of reality. We're absolutely free from any expression whatsoever. It's like someone singing a song, and are they bound by the song they're singing? And no. So we are not bound by any circumstances. We are not bound by any conditions. Nobody has a condition. From my standpoint, no one has any condition whatsoever. So we're all free to express as we like. And we don't have to express as this world. We do not. We don't have to express as this body, the way the condition is in. We don't have to express as this economic system. We don't have to express in that way whatsoever. Nobody does. But it is an expression of our continuity fear that's why we're doing it. That's why we're doing it. This type of expression is not normal for us. Without any fear whatsoever, we would not choose to express this way. We would not. We would not choose to express as bodies of flesh that get old, sick, and die. We would not. We would absolutely would not. So, but we don't have to. We can express as a super functional body to take pilgrimages. That's okay. That's fine. That still, it's a continuity fear expression. But okay, so we're pragmatically helping evaporate the continuity fear. So as you do that, you have need then of expression that suits your continuity fear, and you will. I mean, but I believe there's a lot of people in this world who are thinking, you know what? I don't see this future of this world. I don't see that really being helpful for me. Really don't see it that way. Spoke to a man my own age yesterday, pretty much a little younger. And almost everyone I speak of my generation, we all agree, it's like, wow, this planet is not going in the right direction. This is not good at all. and just a general consensus of this. And I'm sure there are a lot of people who come here more recently also saying, you know what? You know, this really isn't that good for me. It's not going to be. It's delay, too much delay. This planet is too heavily invested in delay. This is how I see it. It's overly invested in delay. And I've not seen anything that's changing the tide. It's like a tide. You know, it's like a tidal situation here. And the tide is so high in investing in delay that it as it said in Scripture, the world will be so in such a bad situation, the end times, meaning high tide of investing in delay, a high delay tide, actually, that even the elect of God, even those who are electing to set all free from all conditions, will be in danger of being pulled into this delay. That's how bad it is. And it's already that bad. We're right there. We're here with that. And that's when Jesus said he will return. And why? To invite us to his place. Pilgrimage planet is how I see it. And I say that because pragmatically, again, you cannot just plop someone from this planet down in some other planet, place, dwelling place, beautiful nature, with nothing to do. You see, we're so obsessed with doing. Only very advanced meditators can handle that kind of situation. Very advanced meditators. So we're so obsessed with doing. You'd have to have something to do. And since you cannot modify nature in this place, okay, cannot modify it. You cannot cut trees down. You cannot deface the landscape. You cannot do those things. It just doesn't happen. Then pilgrimage is what you do. What you do. It's like someone getting up in the morning every day and playing golf. Golf is a type of pilgrimage, actually. You get on the first hole. And you know there's 18 beautiful holes as you wind your way through the mountains and valleys and here and there, you know, and by the river there. And you're going on a pilgrimage, really. You're going on a pilgrimage, and you finally have 18 holes. You finally reach the clubhouse. And you say, you go in, you have some good food and drink, and you sit down, you relax, and you reflect back on how wonderful the pilgrimage is. And a lot of people, retired people, do that every day. They love it. And I wouldn't mind doing that, you know, every day. I've got issues with you know, the shoulders and back and everything. I don't have the money, don't have anything anyway. But the idea is the same, is you can get up every day and really look forward to, wow, what's the pilgrimage today? I can't wait. This should be really great. Who knows what the planet's like? It could be that we just float along. Or there might be flotation devices of some kind that we just sit on, just like a leaf or something, a big leaf. But it's buoyant. And then we just have a little something on the side or something to steer or whatever, guide us. And we just move it for like an electric golf cart, but it's much simpler. There's no technology involved. And we just float along or something like this. Like a raft on a river, kind of thing like that, a raft on a river. And we just float along. And there may be pilgrimages on rivers, actually. Canals. There may be canals everywhere on the planet. And you just float along the canal. Just float. There's another possibility. Either way, maybe you walk or you float. Float on the water along the canal. And you just take in just the incredible beauty of the place. And then you dock. You dock at some point. As sacred, a holy site, where it's the stillness and quiet is so intense. And then you go back on your canal and go on like that. That's how I see it. That's how I see people being helped, spirits being helped now. And what do you need? You're just sitting there on this boat or flotation device just floating along, and you're just sitting there and just, wow, I really enjoy this. This is very nice. Oh, look at over there. Wow, that is incredibly beautiful. I mean, I talked to an old trapper once. He used to go to the Sacramento Delta area, Sacramento, San Joaquin Rivers, the Delta, when there's no people there. I mean, really. Almost virtually no one. He was a trapper. He trapped, riparian animals, the otter, and various, the possum, the raccoon, various animals. He trapped animals or whatever. He said that he would just float along the river, and he said around every bend of that river, there'd be a whole new scene full of animals all over. And he said he just every day he'd get up and he'd just float down the river like this. And he, this is a real old guy, and he told me what it was like, and I was just like stunned. I said, "Wow." He said, "Man, you can't believe it, how peaceful, you know, serene it was, and you never know what you'd see around the bend. You know, it's just something different. It's just that's." So I always remember that. I said, "Yeah, you know, that something like that would be very nice, very nice. People like to take river cruises and stuff, but really, who can afford that? Really, maybe your old people that retire, they've somehow managed to acquire some money through great industriousness and go-getterness, etc. But for a lot of us, you know, such a thing is a total pipe dream. For me, see, for me, I can't do any of that in this world. Totally." Seems totally impossible. So I have zero interest in this world, in that regard, no interest. But if you look at the overall situation in this world, it's a nightmare going forward. The bureaucracy, you know, it's just incredible. This man that was helping me yesterday with the flat tire told me about the bureaucracy that he has to go through and how it's getting worse and worse every day. You know, it's like, oh, new regulation, can't do this, can't do this, can't do this. He said, nope, can't do that. Liability, can't do this, liability. And we're turning this planet of just, you know, where we're all making, you know, liability is just this incredible fear. And I feel it constantly. I can't say that, I can't do this, I better not, I better be. And we're all just like, uh-oh, you know, like, I know I'm going to get sued somehow. I know I'm going to fluster someone the wrong way, say the wrong word. And of course he says, you cannot call the Christmas parade a Christmas parade. You'll get in big trouble if you do. He says you have to call it the children's parade. You cannot call it Christmas parade. That is absolutely forbidden. So, you know, just saying the wrong word. As you get older, you know, you're used to your life, and then you get into this new, you know, fascist bureaucracy, and you're sure to run afoul of it in a thousand ways. How fun is that? It's zero fun for me. Whereas on a pilgrimage planet, there's no bureaucracy at all. You might say it's virtually non-existent. Virtually non-existent. Common sense rules. You know, just overall, get it. You get it. This is what I'm here. This is what happens. And everybody gets it gradually. You know, they really tune in and get it. And it's just straight common sense. You have guides, pilgrimage guides that explain to you, you know, this is what you're doing. You're on like a field trip, kids, come on, and go along. You know, it'd be like spiritual children, sort of, like they say, well, wait, what are we here? This is interesting. Can you tell me what this is about? And the guys will say, sure. And take the pilgrimage, and gradually they get used to it, and used to it, and used to it, like that. Just imagine how nice it would be to be free from any possibility you could ever be sued for anything. How nice would that be? You never have to go to a doctor. You never have to worry about health insurance ever again. Never. Never could be sued. Never could be put in any jail. Never could lose your job. Never could say a wrong word that would cause you to lose your job. Never could have a mob descend upon you because they disagree with your, with what, you know, with your thoughts or ideas or concepts or whatever. Never live in fear of, you know, political correctness at all. And the more you look at this world, the more you realize it's a nightmare. It's a garbage dump nightmare place. Structured by those who have an intense, intense continuity fear. Very intense. And they're hell-bent on trying to find some permanent hiding place. And you can just imagine what the attempts to make a permanent hiding place from what is would entail you wrapping yourself up in some sort of horrible straitjacket. And we don't want to delineate what the sacred places are like necessarily, because the pilgrimage is all about going, finding out. Say, hey, let's take a pilgrimage. I heard the guide says there's a really wonderful pilgrimage site two weeks down the road this way. So we're going to go on this pilgrimage site. It's like, okay, let's, you know. And as you get closer and closer, you start to feel the ambience. And then, and you get there, and it's like a discovery. You're like, wow, look at this place. I just want to sit here and let me just take this in. This is tremendous. And then you get teachings, you get clarifications, you get teachers there who will, you know, clarify and move you towards this where you liberate everyone. You see everyone as free, and that includes you. So you see the totality as free, and that, and you're included in that totality. And then you're enlightened. You're enlightened. You're free because you set everyone else free. There's no bondage in your mind anymore. There's no backstory in your mind. We'll all get to that. We'll all get to that. But the way things are going in this world, I don't have a solution. I do not have a solution for that whatsoever. So hopefully this will resonate with some of you. Hopefully it'll resonate with some of you. And you just say, hey, that, you know, perhaps this is a possibility. Perhaps it's a possibility. I mean, I don't know what Jesus has been doing for the last 2,000 years, right? And the way this planet is going, it sure doesn't look like this is the answer. And he did say he's going to prepare a dwelling place for us, so, and that he'd come back and take us to that dwelling place. So, you know, I'll go on that until I hear differently. All right. Very great. That's it for this video.
Take the high road, lay down our weary load, and rejoice that we're going home to the nearest faraway place where we will live in grace forevermore there. We're not concerned how or the way we'll know to the place that He has prepared so well. So won't you stand up and lift your heads high and sing together, we're going home, yeah. We're going home, yeah. We're going home. We're going home.